know. I know what you have to put up when you're up here. I have to look at the same crowd you have to look at, all right? They're not easy to look at, are they, all right? But anyhow, God bless you. Thank you so much for the good music. Aren't you glad for America? Aren't you proud to be an American, as the song says? And how I thank God for our country. I really do, and I wouldn't want to be anything else but an American. Amen? Got plenty of problems. Some maybe in the White House have been corrected in recent days, but I tell you what, as I said the other Sunday, he's not our Savior. And if you're looking for the White House, the Congress, the senators, whoever you look to in government to be the answer to America, you're looking in the wrong direction. Because the real answer to America is there. Amen? It's God. God's heritage that he's given us as a people and as a nation. Now, I thought about preaching on America today, but I'm going to go ahead with my trend, okay? I want to continue to stay with what we started a couple weeks ago. So turn in your Bible to John chapter 8. John chapter 8. We're in a little mini-series, probably maybe about three sermons long. You go too long in a series, and people get disinterested in it. So we'll try to make this somewhat brief. We began a subject topic last week, for the first week, and we only got to one point. Does that surprise you? Amen? Doesn't surprise you with me, does it? I always prepare too much. I've always been that way. Guys have told me that have read my sermons, or some guys who have heard my sermons, said, you give enough in any one sermon. This is back when I used to preach even longer than I'm doing now. Said, you give enough where we can make it two and three sermons. I guess you could easily. And so I'm trying to learn to condense. Trust me, I really am. But hopefully I'll condense and we'll get this done in three sermons. All right? John chapter 8, I'm going to borrow just one verse of scripture. We looked at all the verses last week. We're just going to take the same text verse that you have on the screen before you today. But before we read that, would you stand in honor reading God's word? And then afterwards we will pray and then we'll get into the message. In John chapter 8, beginning in verse 29, and he that sent me is with me. The Father hath not left me alone. For I do always those things that, and what's the next two words, church? Please him. I do always those things that please him. And that's the subject I want to speak on, please him. Last week we looked at the first point of pleasing him, and we're going to review that, and then we're going right in to the new territory. Let's pray first. Our Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for our country. We thank you that, God, you are why America has been so free and so great for so long. Father, how we praise you for our Christian heritage. We thank you, Father, for the foundations that our forefathers laid in our Constitution. God, that we might still enjoy freedom of religion today, still in America, not freedom from religion. But Father, I pray that God, you would continue to stay your hand on this country, this nation, continue to keep her free, continue to be with those, Lord, that are above us in government, bless those in leadership by state and those even nationally, whether they be in the Congress, the Senate, or even our President and Vice President and his cabinet members. Bless them and may your hand be upon them and guide and direct, and may they look to you for guidance, instruction, and for leadership. Father, thank you for the crowd we have today, despite many people going on vacation, some are having to work. But Father, we thank you for what you're going to do in this place today. And again, I yield my voice, my mind, my heart, my body to you. Holy Spirit, may you take it. May you anoint it. May you give me fresh oil of the Holy Ghost. And Lord God, may I preach today as we please unto the Lord Jesus Christ, not unto men. And Lord, I pray that something could be learned, something could be gleaned, something could be used to feed someone even today. And be a blessing is our prayer and our desire. Lord, if there's anyone should perchance be here that's without Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, save that soul nearest hell today. We'll praise you. We'll thank you for what you accomplished in us, for us, as well as through us. In Jesus' name we pray. We ask, and all of God's church and people said, amen and amen. Last week we looked at the subject of please him. Boy, how we ought to desire, how we ought to have a hunger to want to please God. how we ought to have a desire to want to please the Lord Jesus Christ. We told you it'd be good for us to put signs up everywhere we go. When we get in our car, to have a little maybe note up says just please Him, to remind us that as we drive and where we go, we ought to be busy thinking about Him and pleasing Him. When we go into our kitchen, we ought to have a little sign that just simply says, please Him. Hey, when we have something to watch on TV, we want to have maybe a little sign with two words, please Him. And on it goes. How much do we really desire to please Him? Last week we looked at the first thing that we know. If we're going to please God, we've got to first know what is pleasing to God. What are some ways we can please Him? Last week we shared the first thought, and that is that man, steadfastness pleases God. Man, Paul uses the word steadfast often in the Scripture. And the word faithfulness is the same word. It simply means that we need to stay by the stuff. From the moment we name the name of Christ and we claim Christ as Lord and Savior, we ought to desire, above and beyond anything else, to be faithful unto Him. Hey, it's not important that you're faithful to yourself. Well, that's a new theology today. Just be faithful to yourself. And that's why we hear so much advertising. You do what feels good, just do it. Or if you think it's right, it's okay. And what we've come with an old theology that comes actually from the Old Testament. We're living almost with a lot of mindset today of the book of Judges. Every man did that which was right in his own what? Mind, or his own eyes. And so, ladies and gentlemen, we need to get back to the Bible. We need to get back to God. And we need to please God. And one of the things that pleases God is steadfastness. If you're going to have a steadfastness to God, you've got to have a fixed heart. We shared with you last week. David talks about it throughout the Psalms. The psalmist said, hey, I shall not be afraid of evil time. My heart is fixed. And notice what he said, trusting in the Lord. That just means to be steady. That means to be cemented in concrete. That says, I'm unshakable. I'm unmovable. Because no matter what the rest of the world does, no matter what my neighbor says, no matter what my family thinks, I'm going to keep on loving Jesus. I'm going to keep on serving Him and keep on being faithful unto Him. Amen? That's faithfulness. In order to accomplish that, we need to have a fixed heart. Then secondly, I taught you last week, we need to have a fervent love. When and how often do you just climb up in the Heavenly Father's lap and just simply hug Him on the neck and say, Dad, I don't want anything today. I'm not asking for anything. I just want to tell you I love you. I mean, how often do you really tell even Jesus, Jesus, I know you first love me. I always feel like a hypocrite when I tell Him that. I tell Him that every day, several times a day. But every time I tell Him that, I always add, Lord, I feel hypocritical when I say that because I know how much you love me. And I don't know that I can say for sure that I love you nearly anything like you love me. In fact, I know the truth of that. I don't. But oh, how we ought to be in love with Jesus. Amen. Same way with your mate. You ought to love your mate. Amen. And if you love your mate, you're going to please your mate. And if you love Jesus, you're going to want to do those things that are pleasing and honoring unto Him. Isn't that right? Say amen, church.
Amen.
So we need to realize we need to have a fervent love. And we're going to continue in our faithfulness unto Him. Then we need to also practice and have a forgiving spirit. A lot of people fall out, fall by the wayside. A lot of people cease to be steadfast in pleasing the Lord because they start getting a bitter spirit. They start bearing grudges. They start getting hurt. Hey, listen, there's not a person in this crowd probably, including this preacher, that has been hurt not one time, but multi times. Disappointed many times. But the good news is, thank God, I live for one that is faithful unto the end. Amen? Who has never disappointed, never failed, never faltered with his preacher since the day I met him 42 years ago as Savior. Amen? Thank God the saying is still true. Jesus never fails. Amen, and thank God that He doesn't. But hey, steadfastness pleases God. Hey, back in the long ago in the 1800s, a bad serious snowstorm was taking place in a little town, no name town in England. And in that service, the preacher couldn't even make it. The snow was so bad, almost blizzard condition with the wind picking up. But hey, strangely enough, 19 souls came to church that Sunday. Most of them were closer to the church. Hey, none of the deacons came but one. And his name was John Eglin. John Eglin wasn't a preacher by no means. In fact, he wasn't even a Sunday school teacher. But because they had gathered that morning, some of the people said, hey, it's a shame. Not only should we pray, but man, I think we ought to at least do something from the Word of God. And John spoke up. He said, I'm a deacon, and I sort of feel responsible. He said, I'll give what I can and do what I can, and we'll pray, and then we'll go home. John spoke that day, little beknownst to him. After he spoke, he did give an invitation, even though only 19, and most of them were members of the church. When he gave the invitation for anybody there that had never trusted Christ to be saved, a little boy came forward and trusted Jesus. Actually, he was a preteen. And that boy came down the aisle and gave his heart to Jesus Christ. Now, for the community and for the rest of the church, they probably didn't think much. Well, just a child conversion. But that little boy would grow up and be called to be a preacher of the gospel. He would not only shake England, but he would also shake America for God. And his sermons are still being read, still being influencing multitudes of preachers, not counting multitudes of others. And that young man's name was Charles Haddon Spurgeon. He would go on and give us 63 books, 30-some volumes of what is called the Metropolitan Tabernacle, with Sunday morning, Wednesday night, and Sunday a.m. sermons in full print with full illustrations. Huge volumes. I have many of them. And with that said, that man would go on and literally build, and God through him to take his talent, his gifts, and he had very little according to him, but boy, what a prince of preachers, they called him that. His sermons done something that no other preacher in history in America has ever happened. His sermons made front page stories. They even printed them all over England and Europe. Can you imagine the press printing an entire sermon week after week that Spurgeon preached at the Metropolitan Tabernacle? This young man, the one convert, just 19 people, would go on and through the power of God build the Metropolitan Tabernacle that would seat 3,000 people in the mid-1800s, and they literally packed up every service to such a degree, workers and teachers and officers in the church forfeited their seats so that visitors needing Christ could come in, and they gave tickets so they could come to the house of God. Can I tell you where it all began? One deacon and one mama said, you know what, even though there's a blizzard, even though it's bad, we're going to have church. We're going to push ourselves and we're going to get there. And because they got there and because of someone's steadfastness, Charles Haddon Spurgeon got saved. That's what I'm talking about, amen? You never know what our faithfulness and steadfastness to someone else might even mean. But if we're going to please God, steadfastness pleases him, amen? Being just faithful, staying by the stuff. Bible says one of the things that's coming in the judgment seat of Christ, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 2, is that, man, it is required of all men or stewards that they be what? Faithful. God's going to literally judge us on how much steadfastness we portrayed and we live while we're here for Jesus Christ. Are you with me? Hey, but steadfast is not the only thing that pleases him. Let me give you a second thing. Now, the minute I say this word, negativity starts. And that second word is that, hey, separation literally pleases him. You talk about, what are you talking about, preacher? Man, that's negative. Now you're going to get on that. A lot of people have the wrong concept about separation from the world. But the minute the Bible says we get saved, there is some coming out. Now, the minute we get saved, God separates us as his own. Amen? We're brought into his family. We're brought into his fellowship. And he makes a difference in us from the rest of the world by his claiming, by his naming, and by us being his. Amen? But the minute he saves us, he wants us to start growing in grace and knowledge. Now, not everybody, the minute they get saved, has a lot of knowledge of what's right, what's wrong. But God will start teaching you. And the Holy Spirit comes to help us on the inside to clean up from the inside out. Amen? That's what separation is all about. But most people have what I call negativity about separation. Anytime a preacher starts mentioning separation, they may say, there goes that preacher chasing those planes and go talk about sins today. And man, that's negativity. Can I tell you what it's not? Separation is anything but negative. I want to prove that to you in just a moment. We have a total misconception of when a preacher preaches against or for separation, that we immediately take on a negative connotation. We immediately think, boy, this is going to be a negative sermon. And many people say, here comes the thou shalt not list. Here comes God's hate list. Here comes God's no list and not list. That's not what I'm preaching. Separation from worldliness has everything to do with just pleasing him. Separation has everything to do with showing how much we love him more than we love the things that we used to be tied to. Are you with me? It is not a negative thing. It is always going to be a positive thing. Are you with me?
So, hey, first thing separation is that, hey, it is not only pleasing to him, but, man, it is more than that. It literally is a truth that is a positive thing. So I want you to understand, first thing is it's positive. It's a positive thing. Look at what, no, go back. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14, verse 8. Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness or godliness with ungodliness or unrighteousness? What communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God hath said, I will dwell in them, walk in them, I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Now, what is God saying in that passage of Scripture? That we need to be separate. Verse 17, he comes back, wherefore come out from among them. The them is talking about the world. Now, let me give you what it does not mean. Okay? He's not giving us a list of sins, although there are some in the Bible. God could have simply just wrote down everything that's wrong and said, this is it, boys. This is what y'all stay away from. God didn't do it that way. Rather than do it that way, in many places he did say those things, but in other places he just gives us principles to go by, to live by. Does that make sense? Because principles won't change. Truth won't change. But sometimes words and even maybe to some degree sins change. Now, wait a minute. I didn't mean sin changes in the way it does and what it accomplishes, but sin can change. Hey, anybody think that the disciples knew anything about grass in their day? I'm not talking about the green stuff. Everybody with me? Hey, we've seen grass change in our day, in my day. Grass was something I used to mow. Now it's something you can smoke. Everybody with me? So do you see how sin changes? I'm not compromising saying sin changes to the good. I'm saying sin changes because words change and habits and different kinds of sin can change. Are you with me? But what is this separation all about? Let me give you one word statement I wrote down years ago as I studied this subject. And that is this. Sin is never isolation. But rather, separation is never isolation. But separation is always intended for insulation. And did you get those two words? Isolation versus insulation. You say, preacher, what are you talking about? John, I'm glad you're at the front. Stand up here a second. Let me see if I can. Paul, you're free. Can I please? You're right on the edge. And Grady, I need three of you. That's one. And y'all over here, and most of these are ladies sitting right out here in the front. Would you guys come in just for a second? I want to do some demonstrations, okay? Now, I'm not making anybody look stupid. If you look stupid, you already were, all right? But anyway, here's what I want. I want to teach you a truth, okay? Now, how many of you agree the Bible is saying that we need to be separated from the what? He told us in the passage, separated from the world. Now, let me tell you, there are three usages in the Scripture of the word world, okay? The one world usage is Psalm 18, and this is not on the screen. Psalm 18, where it's used as the planet world, God's creation. Now, we all know God made it perfect, made it good, and it's beautiful, even though it's under a curse because of sin and man's sinfulness. Amen? But the world is planted in many places of the Scripture when he talks about the world. Second world is sometimes it's people. For example, John 3:16, for God so loved the what? Well, who's he talking about? He's not talking about the globe. He doesn't love a bunch of concrete buildings and trees, even though he created it, but he loves who's occupying the globe. And so when in that passage, he's using the world as a reference to people. So the first one he uses as planet, the second one he uses as people, and the third way he uses it, and this is the way we need to look at, is a word which I call a program. It's the mindset. It's the way people are being programmed. And let me say this off the cuff, and in fact, it's not off the cuff, let me just tell you what I believe. I believe if we become as a church, that means any one of us, and we want to become politically correct, determining what that political correctness is, usually most political correctness is anti-Bible and anti-God and anti-Christ. Do you hear me? I love everybody. I'm serious, because I want to love like God loves. Is everybody lovable? No. But I'll tell you what, a lot of this political correctness is nothing more than compromising with the world and worldliness and sin. Are you with me? Does that make sense? But we ought to love everybody, regardless of their gender, regardless of where they stand, regardless of how they live. We ought to love everybody. Everybody with me? But the world program is that which is against God, that which is an opponent against the scriptures and against morality and decency. And on we go. Are you with me? So, John, I'm going to let you stand over here. I don't know how far. How far can that? We got to go over this way? All right, guys, go over this way. Camera's there, not to say that they have to see this online. But anyway, I want John to represent something. I want John to represent the world. Okay? Everybody tell me out there, what does John represent? The world. He looks a little round, doesn't he? I said I won't teach you, John. I'm only kidding, Doc. Hey, man, this guy's working out hard every week. Just started that 3 weeks ago, I think, but it's killing him. But anyway, then I want Grady to represent. Do you need it here? Come over here, John.
John's fine.
Okay?
John's fine.
John's fine?
John was fine.
John's fine. John, back over here, buddy. Okay? Grady, I want to represent. See, that's why I need to be down there. Yeah. I don't like being tied up.
Grady.
But anyway. John represents the world. I want Grady to represent. Can I let him represent a Christian? Are you with me? All right? And I want Paul to represent, if I can, God or Jesus Christ. Okay? So Paul represents who? Somebody tell me. What does he represent? Okay? Hey, I can't get him but so close.
He's good. It's just him. Just him.
I got to have him where I want him.
Okay.
But anyway, so what does he represent, church? The world? Who does he represent?
Christians.
You and I, right? And what does Paul represent? Or who does Paul represent? God or Jesus Christ, okay? Now, what is the Bible suggesting after we come to Christ, the Holy Spirit comes in us, all of a sudden he becomes our teacher. And there's things all of a sudden that we see that really bother us and starts disturbing us on the inside. Maybe things that we did or we're doing or still doing after we get saved. And all of a sudden, something will trigger inside us and say, you know what, God, not do that. Are you with me? That's how it was with me. Man, God cleaned up my vocabulary, my habits, drinking, cussing, smoking. I mean, but that's what God took out. And before you get to negativity, before this sermon's over, you're going to see it's a positive thing. Anything but negative. So, this is the program of the world. Everything that is against God and godliness, okay? Now, he is supposed to what? Stay away from it. Now, let me show you what happens. All right? Now, here's how we get so caught up. Now, that's how he was before he got saved. But the minute he got saved, according to John chapter 17, Jesus said that then he called us out of the world. Okay? So when we're called out of the world, even though we're still living in the world, and all of us are, we are to still be separated from this. Now, here's where people get negative on separation. They do all their time and focus all of their energy and attention on the worldliness they think they got to give up. And they totally omit and never think about how much they could enjoy over here and what God has so much more and better for them. Are you with me? We focus all of our attention on this when somebody starts talking about separation from the world. The sins that are in the world. What do I have to give up? What is God going to expect of me? When, man, what we ought to stay focused on is how close you want to be to him. Are you with me? How close do you want your walk in relationship to be with God? How full of God's abundant living and life do you want to really enjoy on a daily basis? And it depends on how close you want to get to him. But the way you get closer to him is by letting God divide you from this. Are you with me? Everybody got that? Does it make sense? So, hey, he was in the world as a sinner, and he loved the world. Didn't bother him. Anything he did before he got saved didn't matter. But then all of a sudden, God says, hey, I want to save you. I love you. Give your heart to me. Give your life to me. And so Grady gets saved. So all of a sudden, now wait a minute. And this is the problem. You listen to me. I'll move you where I want you to move. Don't you go doing anything on your own. You got that? I'm teasing. So after he comes out of the world, he's still got to live in the world, but now God starts working in his heart to just take little mini steps. Because we're on camera, okay? Little mini steps. And after he's getting in his Bible, he's praying, he's coming to church, he's hearing preaching, he may be online listening to other preachers, and little by little God takes one truth after another, and all of a sudden he starts learning it's not good for him. Those things he had over there weren't good for him. Weren't good for his health? Weren't good for his happiness? wasn't good for his holiness for sure. Here's what God's going to say. God is not a cosmic killjoy. He is saying, hey, you have at it. In fact, one of the Psalms says, nothing good will God withhold from those who know him and love him. Nothing good. So God wants to make your life, I'm going to use bad grammar, good. Bad, horrible grammar. But you get the emphasis, don't you? God wants to make your life much, much better for you. If you just listen, if you just obey, if you just honor him and say, God, I am going to separate myself from the world because you told me to and because it's best for me. And I want to enjoy the kind of relationship I can have with the Lord Jesus and with God the Father. Amen? Right with me? Does that make good sense? Thank you, guys. Give them a round of applause. Would you do that? None of those three guys will win any Emmys. I'll promise them that. Or any Golden Globes or anything else. But anyway, thank you, Paul. I know that's against your grain. But anyway, what am I saying? I'm saying, hey, what pleases God? Steadfastness pleases God. Separation pleases God. Hey, it is a positive thing. It is anything but a negative. Billy Graham, in a sermon many years ago, listen to what Billy said. Our interests today are in ourselves. Now, this was years ago. We are preoccupied with money and material things. Our supreme God today is technology. Our goddess is sex. Most of us are more interested in getting to the moon than getting to heaven. We are more dedicated to material security than inward purity. We give much more thought to what we wear, what we eat, what we drink, and what we can do than who and what we are. Did you hear that? I was in one of his sermons years ago. Can I tell you what he said? He say, man, as the church, those of us say, we're getting too much of the world in us and allowing the world to dictate to us when we ought to truly be influencing the world. How much is the world influencing you? Hey, it's a positive thing. Thank God that it is. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10, Paul writes, Demas hath forsaken me. Notice the next statement. Having loved this present world. I read that to say this. If Demas, who was a follower of the Lord, started drifting on God, started pulling back and pulling away from Paul, then how much more is it possible for you and I in this day and hour to do exactly the same thing, to love the world as he did? Can I tell you why? Because there's a whole lot more things than ever before in this world to pull us away, to pull us apart, and to literally love than ever before in history. You got to understand, when I was growing up as a kid, we had three TV stations. Sometimes one of them didn't come in very plain at that. Are you with me? Today, they have 24 hours, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, channels that I don't even want to tell you exist only because I've read about it. That you can have pumped into your living room every day privately or whatever else. Are you with me? Do you see how sin and days give us more to love, more to take away our time, more to take away our emphasis on spending time in the presence of God? The world tugging, constantly pulling us away. Hey, separation is a positive thing. Jackson Brown, I like, was an author of a little book I have called Life's Little Instruction Book. He said this statement in his book. He said, I've learned that if you give a pig and a boy everything they want, you'll end up with a good pig, but you'll also end up with a bad boy. That's a great statement there, amen? Think about that. But hey, separation is a positive thing. Separation is not only a positive thing, it's a prosperity thing. Psalms 1 and verse 3, blessed is the man. In other words, God's saying, hey, I want to bless your life. Since you gave your heart to me, you want to live for me, I want to bless your home, your marriage, your children. I want to bless you. And he says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of scornful. There's a progression there I don't have time to deal with because the clock's ticking. But there's a progression there even of sin and what can happen in a compromised wife. You first started dealing with it by standing with them. Then the Bible says, then you start walking with them, okay? Then the third thing is you start sitting with them. In other words, you start getting comfortable. When you're usually sitting somewhere, you get more comfortable, don't you? And And so there's a progression of sin there, a progression of worldliness even taught there. But look at verse 2. But his, that's the righteous man, the saved man. But the saved man's delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. Verse 3. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall what? What's he teaching in this verse? He's telling, hey, if you won't walk with the ungodly, if you'll give up some things for me, I'll give you things you can't imagine how good I can bless your life. Are you with me? I don't know about you. I want to live a life pleasing to him first. But secondly, I want the best God's got for my life. Whatever that is, I want God's favor. I want God's blessing. I want God's best upon my life. Amen? So, hey, this is not just a positive message, but it's also for our prosperity. God is wanting us to realize and recognize God wants to prosper you. God wants to bless your life, your family, your home, your children. Are you with me? And that's why sometimes people will say, hey, you know what? You ought not to go there. God, hey, when I was growing up, my mama was the Gestapo. Germany could not have had any worse as far as agents than my mama was. I mean, man, breath checks every time I come in from a date, checking to see if I was drinking. She wanted to know if I was smoking. She wanted to know everything. She did not just trust her son. And that's why I say sometimes parents are foolish to always trust their children. Listen to me and hear me well. I'll say this one time today. Trust must be earned, not to just be given. Mm-hmm. Are you with me? And I failed the trust test early, don't I? So anyway, long story short, my mama would say, even as a little kid, man, I got away, I was telling somebody back here, telling the Kirby's back here in the corner, I got away with things over at my cousin, first cousin Barry Davis, lives in Monroe, just on the borderline of Monroe, a little ways from our house. Man, when I was a little kid, I used to love to spend the night at Barry's house. You say, why? Man, we got to do things at Barry's. I didn't get to do it at mama's house. Number one, they had Cokes all day long. You could drink them in gospel if you wanted to. My aunt was a Coke-aholic. She had these little, you remember those 6.5-ounce bottle ones? Back in those days, stronger, better. I really think they were better Cokes. But, hey, man, you could get them all day long. She had no restrictions. Hey, I was lucky to get one on a Friday. I'm serious. That's how it was. It was only for special occasion we had pop or we had any Coke or Pepsi or whatever. Hey, my parents never had always peanuts around. Man, my aunt lived and had peanuts always. And man, what's a cup without peanuts? Amen? But oh, better still, my parents didn't always have that good aged cheese. Sharp, very sharp. I mean, I'm talking about when you bite into it, it goes. You know what I'm talking about? My aunt had huge vats of that, kept it all the time. And what was neat about going to Ole's house, my aunt's house, was, man, it was cool. Hey, I didn't get to take crackers out of the kitchen, even in to watch TV. Not crackers, because they're messy. They could leave, you know, mess up the house and all that kind of thing. Hey, over at Ole's, we could eat crackers in bed, praise God. Are you with me? Now you know why I loved Ole's house, amen? But I'd come to Mama with something like this. In the early day, Mama, you know what? I want to know, can usually I put up, get somebody put up to asking her. My first cousin would always ask, because I figured, hey, she'll say no to her son real easy, but it's hard to say no to my cousin. It's just something about it. Any of y'all parents ever experienced some of this? You know what I'm talking about? Okay? Let me tell you. I come to Mama sometimes and say, Mama, I sure would like to be able to do such and such and such and such, or go such and such place and such and such. My mama had was notorious. I mean notorious for certain statements. She would always come back. And I'd always come, and I was the tourist, I guess, for always using the same excuse. Well, but Mama, you don't understand. I don't understand why you're against this, because everybody else is going to be there. All my friends are going. You know what she'd immediately always come back to? Well, let me just ask you, son. If all your friends jump off of a cliff, does that mean you want to jump off of a cliff? Duh. Are you with me? What was she concerned about? She was giving me rules to live by when I didn't know what was right or wrong still necessarily in all cases. God, I want you to understand, is not giving us rules to live by. He had brother for us not to learn rules. Christian life is not a ruled life. You don't misunderstand. Don't misunderstand what I'm going to say. Because there's a better Christian life to live than rules.
Christian life is not to be lived by rules. It's to be lived by relationship. Are you with me? I have such a relationship with God. I don't want things out there to disturb how much joy I have. I don't want anything out there to mess up what I got going on with the Heavenly Father. I don't want anything to come between He and I's love life and our prayer life and our time of walking together. I don't want to mess that up. Why? Because I love Him. I know He loves me more than anybody, including my wife. Are you with me, church? So, hey, it's a positive thing. Separation, He's positively doing this to say, hey, church, I want to bless you. It's for your good. It's for your blessing. It's for your encouragement. Secondly, it is not only a positive thing. Separation is positive. But separation is also for you and I's prosperity. God wants to bless our life. And then let me close and simply say, it is also thirdly for your and my protection. We don't see it this way, but God's trying to protect us. God's trying to guard some things in us. I read a story this week online that simply said that the Eskimos have a unique way of doing certain hunting up in the Arctic. And I was mesmerized by reading the accounts of how successful they are doing this. But it particularly is in regards to wanting the fur off of wolves to make their clothing. Because a wolf, man, can live in sub-zero temperature and doesn't get cold, doesn't shiver, shake. I mean, they know that it's made, just like polar bear hay, is made with great insulation. And so they trap wolves to make clothing out of. But they don't use traps because so many back in the old days didn't use it, and they still today in many tribes are still doing the same practices they did years ago. You say, what's that? An Eskimo that's interested in making some clothes, his wife says, hey, I'll make you a new coat, but you've got to get the skins. They'll take a knife, make it razor blade sharp. And then for several days, they will take a dead animal's blood and pour it on that knife outside where the blood freezes. And then they'll come back a few hours later, they'll pour some more blood and it freezes. And what you end up having is a knife of the handle of the knife. The blade's totally covered like an ice cream popsicle. Does that make sense? But it's made out of pure animal's blood. And then a day later, they'll put it in a bucket, bracing it just so, pour water. Within one day, they've got a knife sticking up, totally hidden, in a bucket. And then they'll wedge that ice out of that bucket, and they'll go out where they know there's trails and where the wolves are, and they'll place it in a strategic location. Now here's I'm not trying to be gross. Here's what happens. The wolves, anywhere in the vicinity, starts to smell. Their smell is tremendous. You have no idea how good a dog smell is. And that wolf smells that blood from many times, hundreds and hundreds of yards and maybe even miles, depending on the wind currents. And man, they start coming and running. They know something is dead. It's a free meal. They don't have to run with the pack. They don't have to hunt. Man, this is a free opportunity. They know something is either dying or something is dead. And they can eat. And that wolf will come where that blade is sticking out. They don't see the blade. They don't see because they've done everything without any hands, without any scent being left. They know what they're doing. That wolf will come to that bloody knife and start licking that popsicle and stick licking. And the more blood that enters the wolf's mouth into his system, the more bloodthirsty that wolf gets to where he starts just like you see the dog thirsty. They'll come to a little bit of water and they'll lap a little bit. And after they really cool down just a little bit, then all of a sudden they'll lap real fast. That's exactly what the wolves do. And they lap, and they don't even realize they've lapped through the blood. They're now into the blade. And as they lap, their tongue, it continues to be cut and cut and cut. They don't even feel the piercing. And the story and the bottom line, that Eskimo will come where the trap is, where the blade is, and every time find a dead wolf soon from there because he bled. And he didn't even know what was happening. Now say that and tell that story today. That's what God's trying to warn us about. He's trying to protect us. We said, hey, you go ahead if you want to, but I'm telling you, you'll be a whole lot healthier, holier, and happier if you wouldn't do this. Are you with me, church? Does that make sense? So God is simply saying, hey, it's my protective measure. A coal mine was being inspected by some of the inspectors that do the inspection for the government. They showed up one morning to go into the pit. And I, even though I lived in West Virginia, never went down into the pit. There's one in Pocahontas.
County that is an exhibition mine that you can go down into. And they say, man, there's something else to go into. I preached in Pocahontas, but I've never been into the mine there. But I had a deacon that was in West Virginia. He told me, he said, Bill, until you go down, once you take that lamp that's on your body and you cut that thing out, you have no idea what blackness and darkness really is. There is no darkness on the face of the earth like a mine. Number one, you're in coal. It's black. It's black. You're down in the rock. And there is no sun. There's nowhere to glean any light from. You got to pay the darkest of night. Here you got light. You got the stars. With me? And depending on your vicinity, you've got a lot of houses. You damn sure can see. I can see anytime from my house. Any, no matter how dark it is, up to about midnight. Then it starts going darker because the lights start going out around the community. But I still have the moon sometimes and the stars. But here's the story. They showed up to inspect that mine. When they came in, a lady was dressed in a dress. And it wasn't just any dress. She had a white dress on. And the man looked at her and said, ma'am, said, you did not dress for this occasion. She said, what's wrong with me? Why can't I go in just like I am? And the mind of wisely spoke back and said, yes, ma'am, you can go in just like you are and just like you're dressed. But I will make a promise to you. You will never, no, never come out like you're dressed. You know why? That dust is everywhere. Just one touch against any other, the elevators that carry you down into the earth, or any grazing on the side of the coal itself, it's just dirty and nasty and dusty. And what they were just simply saying is, hey, you may go back in there, but you will never come back like you were. Are you with me? Now do you get the message of protection regarding why God says, hey, watch yourself. It's for your good. I want you to be godly. I want you to enjoy everything I have for you. And when it is for our protection, and thank God that it is. I told you earlier about my mom and my dad. They both had a lot of rules, and I'll be honest with you, I couldn't date. I got a driver's license at 16, and that's when I could date. I started dating when I was 16, first date. Just how it was back in those days, at least at my house. Man, do you realize that my mom actually, and my dad always wanted to know where I was going? Now, I didn't have to worry about what time to be back home. They already said that. You realize at 16 years old, when you have parents like I had, at 16 they let me stay out until 11 p.m. After that they said, you're up to no good if you're anywhere past 11 o'clock. And to be honest with you, after I got older and started living really a lot worse, I realized what they said was exactly true in most cases. Unless you knew where they were in a home or with a girlfriend's parents playing games or whatever. You with me? And so 11 o'clock, can I tell you what that meant? The girl had to be home at least by 10:30. If she lived out in Amherst County, I had to get home before 10:30. Can I tell you how cool that ain't? Emphasis on ain't. It's hard to be cool with a girl going home at 10:15. When you're 16, when 17, they let me go 30 minutes longer. By the time I was getting ready to be a junior, senior in high school, they bumped it up to 12 midnight. That was a mistake. But anyway, that's another story. But I'm simply saying, hey, it was hard to be cool, but I had rules and guidelines to follow. Hey, it wasn't cool also when I was 16. I didn't have my car yet. My first car was purchased when I was 16. Later after becoming 16, I purchased a 1968 Mustang. 67 Mustang. Cool. Four-speed, 283 four-barrel, glass pipes coming out the back. Back in those days, they had the leather roofs. You remember the leather roofs? It wasn't convertible. They had, I forgot what they call those tops. But hey, but when I started dating under mom and dad's rules and regulations, it's really not hip and not cool to have to drive a 66 Chevy Impala that's dark green. Right there, John. Would you please? One more demo. Here's what God's saying to every one of us. When he gives us what we call thou shalt not, okay? Here's what God is saying to every one of us. Listen to me well. I want John to represent a big, mean pit bull dog. Okay? Not just any pit bull, because not all pits are mean, but he's been trained, taught that way. I want Grady, even though he is really not looking like one, I want him to be like a little French poodle. Don't he look cute? I got news for you, Grady. You're the ugliest French poodle I've ever seen. Wait, I'm kidding. All right, now, here's where I want to show you protection. French poodle over here, right down this corner right here is a big fence. Master of the French poodle put up, and then let the dog roam its backyard because it's protected. Are you with me? But here it is in the backyard having a good time, and all of a sudden, Chris Buddha starts thinking to himself, you know what? Boy, there's another dog over on the other side. Boy, I'd like to get over there and play with him or her. I can smell it, man. That dog will come over here and bark at the French poodle, and man, there's danger. But all of a sudden, the French poodle thinks, you know what? My master don't really care about me. My master really doesn't love me. If he really loved me, he'd tear down that fence and let us get together and play and romp and have a good time. What the French poodle doesn't realize, this old boy over here is looking at him, I'd like to eat that one for lunch. Everybody with me? Do you get the message? Do you get the truth? The master has put the fence up for one reason only, to protect, because he loves who he's protecting. That much. Are you with me? And God has put some barriers up in our lives at times. And some of you may be newer Christians, you're going to discover there's a barrier going to be popped up. It's not to hurt you, it's to help you. It's to protect you. It's to prosper you. It's a positive thing, never a negative. Let me close with it. Thank you, guys. Let me close with this. Again, to remind you, the Christian life is never, never to be lived by rules, but it's to be lived by having a relationship. What kind of relationship do you enjoy with Jesus Christ? What kind of relationship this morning do you enjoy with God the Father? God is saying to us, man, if it does anything to make you happier, holier, and healthier, just help yourself. I want every head bowed and every eye closed. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed, no one looking around. I want to ask a question just before we close. I want to ask this question. Would there be anybody in this service today? Some have to leave. They got lunch appointments and other things, places to go. But could I ask those of you who are here today? Is there somebody seated here today that could say with a raised hand, preacher, I got to be honest, be real. I don't know that I know that I know for sure, for real, that if I died today, that I'd go to heaven. I don't really know that I have any relationship at all with God. I don't really know that I've enjoyed what you've talked about today, having a relationship with this person, Jesus Christ. But I recognize a need. I sense a need to know him, to trust him. I realize I'm a sinner. I realize Christ loves me and died for those sins. And I realize that he invites me to come and trust in him. Preacher, I know that's my need. Today in this service, preacher, would you pray for me? Would you pray about me? I'm not going to embarrass anybody, but if you're here like that today, would you just right now, with every head bowed, every Christian pray? Would you just raise your hand real high and simply say, raise it and say, preacher, that's me. I don't know that I know that I know that if I died right now, I'd go to heaven. Don't know that I know I have a relationship with this Jesus Christ. But I realize and recognize I need to have one. I want to have one. Just put it up and then put it right back down. Just put it up real high and put it right back down. Preacher, I need that. I want to have that and experience that. Anybody at all? Before we pray. Second part of the invitation is simply this. If you're here, God has focused something in your heart. The Holy Spirit has maybe circled something. I beg and plead with you in Christ's stead. If God says, hey, that's not good for you, then give it to God. God's got something better to replace it with. Always. Just give God what he wants, what he wants. And I'll guarantee you, God will bless your life in a greater way. God will take you and you'll enjoy a closeness to him as you seek to please him in all that we live and we do. Third part of the invitation is simply this. If you're here seated today and you need a church home, a church family, a place to belong. We've had, I think, 9 this month of the month of June joining you not with our fellowship. But if there's somebody seated here today, a family, an individual, and you know you're saved, you've been baptized, but you need to find a church home, our doors are open to receive you today. You come in this invitation. So the invitation is simple. If you need to be saved, you come. If you need to just consecrate and recommit your life to Jesus Christ and rededicate your home and your heart to him, you come. Then if you need to come and say, preacher, I feel like this is where God would have me come and grow in the grace and knowledge of Christ and serve him, our doors are open to receive you. You come. Would you stand prayerfully where you are, heads bowed, eyes closed, no one looking around? Our Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for God, this place. Thank you for this church. Thank you for these, my people, and your people. God, thank you for what you're doing. Thank you for what you've done. We continue to expect even greater things in the days ahead.
God, today we need to focus on this invitation, this time, this hour. God, if there's one in this place today that doesn't know that they know that they know where they're going to spend eternity, they die. If there's one watching by internet that doesn't know that how much you care, how much you love them, that Jesus Christ died for their sin, that I pray those maybe watching by internet might too be convicted and they might come to Jesus Christ and invite Christ in to become their Lord, their Christ, and their Savior, to ask His forgiveness and for His so great salvation. So, Father, speak to our hearts in this invitation time. Do what you will, what you want. We'll praise you in Jesus' name. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed, no one looking around. The instrument begins playing very, very soft, and the music begins playing. And as that music plays, if you need to come, if there's something you need to do today, you come right now, this hour, this moment, you let God have His will, have His way. Would you come? Come on. Jesus. That's the key. All right. Thank you for your gracious attention. I trust you will make this week a great July the 4th. Enjoy whatever you do on the 4th, fireworks, cookout, whatever. Let's pray. Let me give you one request. If you would, do remember.
Lou Meadows.
Miss Lou Meadows. Would you remember her? She is down in Richmond. Was rushed there just in the last couple of days. And she needs a lot of prayer right now. Would you do that? And don't need to know all the facts, the details, but just remember Lou. If you would, continue to pray for Daryl. And certainly Fred, and they continue. And I know that Miss Ward is still having some treatments and maybe finished up this week possibly, and looking forward, hopefully, to a future transplant. So continue to bear them up before the Lord in prayer. All right, let's go to the Lord in closing in prayer. Brother Philip Brown, good to have you and your family. Would you dismiss us, please, sir?